How's that kink in your neck? Is your wrist bothering you a little bit? Well, I don't know you that well. It may just be an old sports injury you have. But if you're watching this webinar, you, like me, might be on your computer for a long period of time. In fact, surveys show that many office workers are on their computer for a longer period of time than they sleep in bed. With this type of behavior, ergonomics, the study of the office and how things work in the office, is something, a science that's looked more and more. And we're going to go over some things that you can do yourself to be more comfortable, what we call healthy computing. Now, let's put a caveat here. I'm not a doctor, nor have I played one on TV, and I don't think anyone else in here is a doctor. So we're not going to, what we're talking about is stuff that we've researched over years and have talked to doctors and how people work in the workplace. But again, every body is different. So some of these things may not work for you, and you want to talk to a professional about that. But what we're studying here is stuff that has worked a lot for general people over a long period of time. So that's what we're going to study today. Now, this picture here, you may have seen. In fact, it may be something like this in your hallway at an office. This is how you should be at your computer. And there's a lot of things going on here. I'm not going to cover all of them. You can certainly look at it and kind of, you know, look at how you're sitting right now at your computer. But there's a few things here that I think are quick things you can do right away that can really help with being comfortable at the computer. One is the top of your monitor. Now, I'm on a laptop right now, and this is not my normal positioning, but back in my office, is your monitor eye level? Can you raise up your monitor? I mean, we used to do it with phone books. I guess now you could do it if you borrow a couple of reams of paper from the printer, or if you can find some sort of a stand. You want your monitor up at eye level so your eyes will scan naturally down the page instead of moving your head up and down. So that's one thing you want to do. You also want to keep the monitor at least arm's length. Now, a lot of people don't want to do that because they need to bring it closer to read the text. This monitor I have here, this laptop, is an HD display. When it's on full resolution, the print was really small for me to read. And, you know, I don't want to squint because in my old age, I may have glasses if I can continue that up. No laughter. It's a very tough room here. But what I've done and what you can do, and we have links in the office blog for this, is we can make the print larger in Windows. So if your computer stays away, I have on this computer, I have it at 125%. And we can show you that in the Q&A, or I have links in the blog. So you want to keep your monitor at least an arm's length away. Another one that is really, really easy to do, and this is one that really got me, is you look at this picture here about the arm positioning. Okay, the elbows are free, the wrists are in line with the forearm, and they're not resting on anything. I think about it as a piano player, right? A piano player is not resting wrists on the piano. I don't think they technically can, but they have their hands free because they're moving their hands up and down. That's kind of the positioning that you want with your hands and your fingers. Now, my story is how I got into ergonomics is because I had some problems a couple years ago. At a previous job, we changed buildings and I got a brand new chair, and I got them with armrests that were adjustable. And I think in the back of my mind, I had the idea that my arms should be straight, but I started resting my elbows on the armrest. And after a while, I developed some problems in both my wrists. So I talked to some folks about it and went to a doctor and figured out that's a bad thing to do. So what I did was I immediately went back to my office and turned over my chair and took a screwdriver and literally unscrewed the armrests because I couldn't adjust them, which got a couple funny looks in the office that day. What's Doug doing over in his cubicle? But it made me so I was not even, if I was lazy, I wouldn't be able to put my arms down. And over time, that's what helped my arms feel better. So those are some things you can do. There's some other things, again, we can talk about it in the Q&A. I once had a foot rest because I was a little high on the computer. That can help also. Some of these things are great reminders to have from time to time. A couple things about just talking about ergonomics and what we call a neutral position is just how your hands, if you think about when you hang them, of how your wrists and your arms are in this what's called a neutral state. That's what you want. You don't want to be having your hands in a position that's kind of funky for a long period of time or repeated movements. So to get your hands in this type of neutral position is important. This is some of the studies that go into when we design hardware. Now, a lot of people thought we started just designing hardware last year. Microsoft has built hardware for more than 30 years, and they've been working with ergonomic mice and keyboards for more than 20 years. And this type of research and talking to office workers and talking to professionals is how they design hardware. They want a more comfortable keyboard. They want something that will allow you to use these natural arcs in your hand. I mean, look at the hand here. Your hand, even in a neutral position, has a natural arc to it. Your fingers, of course, aren't straight lines. They have different places, different heights where they come to. This is kind of the stuff they look at when they're working with designing keyboards. So we're going to talk about that here now. And there's actually a brand new one that came out just a few weeks ago. And this is the Sculpt Ergonomic Desktop that has a couple arcs going for it. Let me show you a couple of these things. One is called a gable angle. That's the curve here that makes it look a little like a mountain. And then there's also, this is a split keyboard. So there's actually a 12% arc for your hands fall. Now I'm kind of putting my hands in a wrong position, but your hands have a bit of a curvature to them naturally. So that's why the keyboards are set up. Actually, if you notice, some of the keys aren't the same size. I mean, think about it. Keyboards were based on typewriters. Typewriters were based on pushing a button and having a lever hit paper. It wasn't really concerned about where your hands were physically. So that's why they've worked on moving the keyboard and all of this. A lot of people might have seen one of the early ergonomics. In fact, I've seen a lot in the office. We built one several years ago that was white, kind of looked like a big mountain, had this mound in the middle. One of the things that Sunil was talking about, I thought was interesting, was when they were talking to workers about what they want in their keyboards, they want something that was nice. They want something that felt good. So where that first one kind of, I think, felt like it had a lot of air in it, probably did. This is really secure. Instead of that mound, it's got this notch, which I guess could be a quick Halloween mask if you wanted to. But it's built really well. There's a nice, supple wrist pad. This is for resting your hands when you're not typing. You don't rest that. There's some other things working on here with these keyboards. So the ergonomic keyboard is one that you might want to look at. One of the things that comes with this keyboard that's kind of interesting is the 10 key is actually separate. It actually its own little separate keypad. So one thing they found out is a lot of people don't use it that often. They don't do a lot of typing. They're not maybe doing Excel a lot. So, but they're reaching over a lot with their pinky to grab, if they're typing in a couple numbers and an address. And that reaching with the pinky can cause shoulder problems over time, believe it or not. So if you have a keypad, if you're just doing a few numbers, just use the numbers in off the top of the keyboard. But if you need it for, and I'm perfect for this because there's one or two days a month that I'm working on metrics and I need to be typing a lot of numbers. So I want the 10 key with me so I can put that right next to me and use it. And when I don't want it, I just kind of move it away and have less clutter on my desk. I guess if I was left-handed, I could also move it over to the other side of the keyboard if needed. So that's part of the Sculpt Ergonomic Desktop. We'll talk about the mouse in just a moment. Now, that 12% split keyboard, that's, I think for touch typists, that's going to be easier to pick up than a hunt and peck typist. But one thing and you may want to look at is just a different type. This is called the Sculpt Comfort Keyboard. It's, again, doesn't have that severe 12% split keyboard, but it does have a curvature. It's a 6% arc, and it does allow for some ergonomic benefit with your hands. This is a keyboard I've used for several months, and I really do like it. Again, I'm not a touch typist, so that arc is a little uncomfortable for me to get used to. I'm trying. But the Sculpt Comfort, again, gives you some ergonomic benefit without that severe split of the keypad, which throws off some folks. Let's talk a little bit about a mouse. I'm going to give you a story about my favorite mouse, this one here. This is an old mouse. This is I've had this for, I think, 8 years. This is the old Natural Laser 6000. It's a big mouse. But one of the things, it does have some ergonomic benefits of how you can see the thumb scoop there and the way you kind of just kind of rest your hand on it as you mouse. It's got four-way functioning, some back keys. I really enjoyed it. And I liked it so much that I actually would, it's an older mouse, so it came with this receiver I had to always carry around with me. But I did it because it was so comfortable for me. It works really well. In fact, I bought a second one, and I even bought a third one at a garage sale. But it had a lot of benefit for me. Now, one of the other benefits it has is dealing with the sensitive areas of your wrist. If you do a normal mouse, this picture I've shown up here, the big white area, that is where your wrist is in contact with the desk as you mouse around. The blue areas, that's the sensitive area of your wrist that might lead to in the carpal tunnel area. So the darker the blue, the more sensitive the area. So you're constantly on that area of your wrist if you have this type of mouse. With this natural mouse or an ergonomic mouse, one, the blue area is much smaller, and two, you're not contacting the desk with it. You're using this fleshy part, if I can use that word, fleshy part of your hand here to, that's what's contacting the desk. So you're not even hitting that part of your wrist. So that's another, again, that's the science and the research that we put into designing types of mice. So I always wondered, I love this, but when are they gonna update it? Aha! With the Sculpt desktop comes the Sculpt ergonomic mouse. So it's an updated version of this. It's a little sleeker, looks a little cooler. Same thing, four-way scrolling. It's got the nice thumb scoop. It's got a back button and also the Windows button, so I can immediately go to my start screen. And that comes with, you can get with the keyboard, also has an on and off switch. It's not Bluetooth, it does, but where I don't have to have the receiver, the dongle, it's not the right word, or transmitter comes right, you can put right in the mouse. So that's the kind of the upgrade of the mouse. So this will become my new favorite mouse very soon as I get a little more used to it. You know, it's hard to, you know, when you get a new blankie, it's hard to switch over right away. But I've been waiting for that update for a long time. One other quick thing you can do is take a break from time to time. It's what I call doing laundry duty. When I work from home, I do the laundry, and you know, every 20, 25 minutes is a new load or something like that, or the buzzer goes off. To get up and stretch is a great idea, to focus your eyes at something that's not your screen. I literally have put a timer next to a computer for one of my daughters who enjoys her computer time, but it goes off every 20 minutes. And I say, but I'm playing a game or I'm talking to someone. I said, it literally take 30 seconds. Get up, stretch, look out the window. It's all I want you to do. Now what happens is half the time she'll get up, she'll stop what she's doing, but she'll, if she's in some bad position or if you're in some bad position, just taking a quick stretch break, you get back in, you might think about, oh, I need to sit properly. You might not realize you've been hunching your shoulders for the last 20 or 30 minutes. So just even a 30-second break to get your body realigned, you might come, if you go out and just, you know, go out in the hallway and come back in, you might realize, oh, I have to do some paperwork, something that's not a computer item. And for my daughter, I mean, half the time she literally will say, oh, let's go pet the dog, or I need to get a drink. She'll get up and walk around even, which is even better. So again, taking a break is another quick thing you can do to help you be more comfortable at your computer. For the little time I have remaining, I want to talk really quickly about tablets, right? We love them, right? They're lightweight, they're really cool, you can do a lot with them. But there's one heavy item that comes with all laptops. And, well, if you're on video, I'm going to show it to you. I'll tell you what it is in just a second. But as you're working on the laptop and you're doing this, you have a heavy item, and it's your head. Your head that weighs as much as a bowling ball. Don't worry, mine does too. But if you start crouching over and typing and working with your tablet, your neck and your shoulder might have some problems. Doctors have noticed this. So to get up and get into a better positioning for typing helps. Now, a lot of times you just curl up on the couch and watch a movie. I understand that. Please have another light on at least in the room, please. But for workers that take tablets with them, they go back to the hotel room and they might do some email. After a while, they realize they're on their lap and they're crunched over. So to get a mobile keyboard is a really great idea. We've talked about this one before. This came out a year ago. It's called the Wedge Mobile Keyboard. One thing that's really great is it's got a thick, thick rubber cover. And with that, you could put it right on your tablet and not scratch it, and you can hold them together. So you have a good grip on everything. The other thing I love about this Wedge keyboard is the rubber cover is also an on-off switch. So now the keyboard is on, and it saves battery life. And this also works as a stand, so you can hold up your keyboard, whatever it is. It's a Bluetooth keyboard, so it will work with any tablet. And this way, if you are back at the hotel and realize you have an hour of email you need to do, again, it's not an ergonomic keyboard, but you have a keyboard, you're able to type faster than you can on the screen. You can maybe prop this up with the phone books, I think those are still in the hotel rooms, and get in a better positioning for doing that computing. So that's a little bit about tablets and the Wedge keyboard. That's all the time we have for today. But all the hardware I talked about here, I have linked at this address, aka.ms/ergo123. I also have links to the reports that have come out. We studied about over 5,000 workers around the world and found some interesting numbers about what people think about being comfortable at the computer. You can find all that at aka.ms/ergo123. Anything about the Office Webinar Series in general, you can go to aka.ms/offweb. You can leave us questions there. That'd be great. Next week, we'll be talking about how to use animation in PowerPoint without being dorky. That's my promise to you. But for today's Office Webinar team, thank you for joining this Office 15-Minute Webinar.